Okay, so second line of defense. So these are considered internal defenses. So if something has penetrated through a wound in the skin, or if it has penetrated through the mucosa. And so we have our non-specific phagocytic cells. And so phago means eat, so cells that eat. So they're gonna engulf and destroy pathogens that breach that surface. Neutrophils, we said those are our little first responders. They leave the bloodstream. They are highly phagocytic, but they're smaller. They can't eat over and over again. Monocytes in the blood become macrophages. Some of these are fixed. So we have like Langerhans in the cells. You have dust cells in your alveoli, so air sacs in your lungs. Other are monocytes are circulating, and then they can leave circulation. So we see these in chronic infections. So remember that process. We've looked at it already. They can leave through the capillaries through diapedesis, and then they are called to that area of infection through chemotaxis. And so they're gonna eat things. So engulf and ingest. And so, yeah, let's take a look at a neutrophil in action.
Neutrophils are white blood cells that hunt and kill bacteria. In this spread, a neutrophil is seen in the midst of red blood cells. Staphylococcus aureus bacteria have been added. The small clump of bacteria release a chemoattractant that is sensed by the neutrophil. The neutrophil becomes polarized and starts chasing the bacteria. The bacteria, bounced around by thermal energy, move in a random path, seeming to avoid their predator. Eventually, the neutrophil catches up with the bacteria and engulfs them by phagocytosis.
So we looked at this before. So we know neutrophils are capable of phagocytosis. We talked about macrophages. We'll talk about them again in just a second. And eosinophils are also capable of phagocytosis. But the big ones are going to be the neutrophils, the macrophages, and the dendritic cells. So monocytes can differentiate into macrophages, or they can differentiate into dendritic cells. Dendritic cells are professional antigen-presenting cells. And yes, I've given you this picture, don't think I'm a sicko, but if you're a Game of Thrones fan, you know, when you vanquish a foe, you cut off their head, stick it on a spike, and then show it to everybody else. So macrophages, dendritic cells, and I know I'm ruining it for you, B cells later, they can actually present a piece of a foreign invader and then go activate that adaptive immune system. So they're going to present them to the T cell. So I'm just kind of saying, hold on to that thought, but they don't just eat things. These dendritic cells, they're going to specifically eat things and then go activate the immune system. And so those Langerhans cells of the skin, those were an example of those types of cells. So antigen presenting cells, it's coming up later. So like I said, our big eaters are going to be the neutrophils, the macrophages, and the dendritic cells. So they scout, recognize, and destroy. So this T helper cell, so leaving the thymus, this cell needs to be presented with an antigen. So T helper cells can't respond to free antigens laying around. And this is the most pivotal cell in the immune system. It is necessary for all of our adaptive immune system. So that humoral immunity through antibodies and B cells, and that cytotoxic killing of those cells, killing our viral infected cells or tumor cells. So just kind of hold that thought. Antigen presentation, it's a big deal. So what's gonna help those phagocytic cells is something called opsonins. So what helps them to eat, and I've given it to you as ketchup, you can think about it like Velcro, is antibodies, and that's what's showing those little protective immune proteins made by those plasma cells, or something we're gonna meet in just a minute called complement. Those are also proteins of the immune system, help phagocytes eat things and do their job. It helps them grab hold. So when a invader, like a bacteria, has these opsonins coating them, it basically targets them for destruction. We're gonna watch a YouTube.
In phagocytosis, phagocytes are attracted to the area of invasion by chemical products of the microorganism, phospholipids released by injured mammalian cells or by components of the complement system. The phagocyte moves into the area of invasion and then attaches to the microorganism. The attachment is mediated by a variety of surface receptors, including antibody, lipopolysaccharide, and complement receptors. For example, the C3b component of complement coats bacteria or other particles and then binds to C3b receptors on the phagocyte. This process of coating to enhance phagocytosis is called opsonization. The microorganism is then engulfed by the phagocyte into a vacuole known as a phagosome. Vesicles in the cytoplasm called lysosomes fuse with the phagosome, releasing digestive enzymes such as lysozyme and proteases into the phagosome. The structure resulting from this fusion is called a phagolysosome. Inside the phagolysosome, microorganisms are killed and digested. Finally, the digested contents of the phagolysosome are eliminated from the phagocyte by exocytosis.
That was that burping. No, just kidding.
In fact.
Okay, so just to kind of recap what we just saw. So those complement proteins, which we're going to talk about those in just a second, they can act as chemoattractants. They can also act as opsonins. And that just helps those phagocytic cells grab hold and engulf things. And then once they engulf it, they bring it in through endocytosis, through a vesicle called a phagosome. We have the lysosomes, those digestive enzymes, and then it can just release the waste products. And that's what we mean by cellular debris. What you told you? Aerosmith and Chemotaxis. Didn't know that was the second title of that song. It wasn't Walk This Way, it was Chemotaxis. All right, so our next part of our innate immune system are going to be those natural killer cells. And the name kind of already tells you what they do. They are going to promote apoptosis, so cell suicide, by directly attacking virus-infected cells or cancerous body cells.
Of all the immune system's soldiers, natural killer cells are the most aggressive. They are lymphocytes with no immunological memory and are part of your innate immune system. Natural killer cells make up about 5 to 15% of the total circulating lymphocyte population. Natural killer cells are called natural killers because they do not need to recognize a specific antigen before releasing their toxins and destroying a viral infected cell or cancer cell. They target tumor cells and protect against a wide variety of infectious microbes. In several immunodeficiency diseases, including AIDS, natural killer cell function is abnormal, thus allowing the viruses to multiply inside of human cells. Natural killer cells kill on contact. The killer cell binds to its target, aims its weapons, and then delivers a lethal burst of toxins that produces holes in the target cell's membrane and creates events that destroy the cancer cell membrane and cleaves DNA into many pieces in a programmed cell death, that is, apoptosis manner. After releasing its lethal package of chemicals, the natural killer cell can detach from the cancer cell and kill many other circulating abnormal cells. Indeed, research has shown that most of the tumor cells that enter the circulation are destroyed during the first 24 hours, and only a few cells succeed in establishing themselves in distant organs from the primary tumor, which is called metastasis. Natural killer cells may also contribute to immunoregulation by secreting high levels of influential lymphokines. Therefore, research to develop natural products to stimulate the natural killer cell activity, especially in immune-suppressed patients undergoing chemotherapy for cancer, or in any viral disease, such as AIDS or bird flu, where immune suppression occurs, is very important in the regulation of aspects of the immune system, which affects our overall health. Finally, we come back to the beginning of our knowledge of the natural killer cell. Here lies a natural killer cell in a lawn of sheep red blood cells. These cells are perfect targets for the natural killer cell, possessing no MHC1 receptor. The wrath of natural killer cell is fully vented on the surrounding sheep red blood cells. The cytotoxins completely destroy the sheep red blood cells, leaving clear plaques around the natural killer cell. There is no apoptosis event, just direct cytotoxicity. The natural killer cell is one of the key soldiers in the fight against viral and cancer growth.
Okay, so natural killer cells, what they're going to respond to is if anything is already coated with antibodies, and like I said, these are the immune proteins made by those plasma cells. You can drink them, they're not toxic on their own, but they do coat things and target them for destruction. And one of the cells that can destroy things that are coated with antibodies are the natural killer cells. The other things, I don't know if you caught it in that YouTube, the first, that little funny little satellite thing that was docking and they were showing you was a virus. And then it showed it injecting its genetic material. And then I don't know if you caught that little yellow ball that was then displayed on the surface of that body cell. So virus and tumor cells, they can display a piece of that virus onto their MHC1. And so a natural killer cell can detect when cells are stressed. So it changes that barcode or they've lost their barcode. They're gonna kill in a method very similar to our cytotoxic T cells. So I'll show it to you in the next episode. But they are still part of that innate immune response. They do not get better over time. So they have no immunological memory. Yeah. I don't know why I didn't take out that slide, but there you go. You can read that.